In this video, we are going to discuss how to diagram ionic bonds. And before we get started, we're going to review the fact that an ionic bond is one that occurs between a metal and a nonmetal. And if you remember, metals are the majority of the elements on the periodic table. In this diagram down here at the bottom, metals are pictured in purple, and nonmetals are pictured in green. So everything that's really on this left side of the periodic table are metals, and everything that's over on the right side is a nonmetal. When these two elements bond together, when a nonmetal and a metal bond, there's going to be a transfer of electrons. So one element is going to lose an electron to become a positive ion, and the other element is going to gain an electron to become a negative ion. And if you remember, an ion is an element that has a unbalanced number of protons and electrons. So let's give an example. Let's take a look at sodium and chlorine. So let's say that sodium is here, it's element number 11, is going to bond with chlorine. And so chlorine is here, element number 17. It's a nonmetal. So the first step that we need to do is figure out what do their Lewis dot structures look like, and let's draw those before they bond. Well, the symbol for sodium is Na, and it's in this first group. So if you remember, everything in group 1 always has one valence electron, so we're going to draw that one dot next to the sodium. And then chlorine, its symbol is Cl. Don't forget that the second letter in any symbol is always lowercase, so that's an L, not an I. And chlorine is in group 17, which means that it has 7 valence electrons. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. My little dots look a little bit funny. I should probably make my pen bigger. Let's try this again. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Well, they're kind of messy dots, but you get the idea. So there's 7 valence electrons around chlorine, and there's only 1 valence electron around the sodium. So we're going to add these two together, and we're going to see how they're going to interact with one another. Well, sodium has this 1 valence electron. It has 11 electrons total because its atomic number is 11, but only one of them is in the outermost shell, which means if it can get rid of that one valence electron, it would have a full shell of 8 underneath. So sodium really wants to get rid of that electron. And if you remember, all metals are electron donors. So sodium is really going to transfer its one electron to chlorine because chlorine is just looking for one more. It is just shy of 8. It has 7 valence electrons. So if it had one more, it would have a happy outer shell. So when we draw this, we start out with the Lewis dot diagrams. We put a plus sign in between, and then we show with an arrow where the transfer of electrons is going to take place. So we've drawn that arrow here, and then we're going to draw a little arrow here to say what happens after this electron transfer occurs. And now we can draw these as ions. And remember, with ions, we draw them with brackets. And sodium becomes a positively charged ion, and chlorine becomes a negatively charged ion. It now has more than one electron than it had before. The other thing that you can do to show that the electrons were moved is to now draw all 8 over with the chlorine. The sodium, we usually don't draw anything with the sodium, even though it does have a full shell underneath. We leave the valence electrons off just because it's lost its one valence electron now, just to show where it went. So this is the kind of format that we use to show how ionic bonds form. Okay, so the other thing to talk about is how we name these new compounds that have formed. So when sodium bonds with chlorine, we give it a new name. And the rule for naming these types of bonds, so ionic bonds between a metal and a nonmetal, is really simple. You simply name the metal, sodium, and then we name the nonmetal, but we drop the ending of the nonmetal and we change it to an ending that's with IDE. So this would be sodium chloride. Okay, so the compound name that we've now created when sodium and chlorine bond together is sodium chloride. So let's take a look at another example. Let's say that we have magnesium, and I want to bond magnesium with fluorine. Okay, so let's figure out how we're going to draw this. The first step that we need to do is figure out what the Lewis dot diagrams for each of these look like before they bond. So magnesium is in group 2, and it has 1, 2 valence electrons on the outer shell, plus fluorine, its symbol is just F, and it is similar to chlorine in that it's in group 17, so it has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 valence electrons. Okay, these two things are going to bond together, and if you'll notice, magnesium has 2 valence electrons that it's trying to give away. If it can give away both of those, there's a full shell underneath and it's going to be happy. But fluorine can only accept 1 of those valence electrons. It doesn't really want 2. But the way that we can make this work is if we add an additional fluorine, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, then magnesium can give 1 of its valence electrons to this fluorine and 1 of its valence electrons to this fluorine. And then everybody's happy. So if you're trying to bond metals and nonmetals, then you need to look and see if there's a different ratio of those atoms that you can create so that everyone is kind of happy at the end. All right, so now we need to draw the ion form of all of these atoms now that they've transferred their electrons. So we're going to draw our brackets to show that there's an ion being formed. Magnesium has lost both of these electrons, so it now has a positive 2 charge. And then we have 2 fluorine atoms to account for, and each of them is only a charge of negative 1, but they all have a full shell. So we'll draw all those electrons around the outside, and the charge is going to be negative 1 here. So let's look at writing the chemical name, or naming this. So the rule for naming, again, is you name the metal. So this would be magnesium. And then we're going to name the nonmetal, but we're going to change the ending. So instead of fluorine, it's fluoride. This is magnesium fluoride. The other thing that we can do is write a chemical formula for this, and I should have shown you that with sodium chloride as well. But with magnesium fluoride, it's a little bit easier. We just literally write the symbols, Mg, and then we include a subscript for how many of these atoms we have. Well, there's only 1 magnesium, and we don't write 1s in our subscripts, so we leave a 1, but it's invisible. And then we write the symbol for fluoride, which is F, and then we write the subscript, how many fluorines did it take to create this? And it turns out that it took 2. So this is the formula for our new compound, magnesium fluoride, would be MgF2. If we go back and take a look at sodium chloride, we should have written the formula for that as well. We would simply write the symbol. How many sodiums did we have? We just had 1, so there's an invisible 1 there. And we write the symbol for chlorine, and then how many of chlorines we had, which is just 1. So there's no subscripts written here, it's just NaCl, which you've probably seen before, right? That's the compound used for common table salt. All right, so we've gone over how to draw ionic bonds using Lewis dot and these ion brackets. We've talked about how to name metals when they bond to nonmetals, and we've also talked about how to write the chemical formula.